Welcome to Raye Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scripture.
An elderly woman had just returned to her home from an evening church service, and she was startled by an intruder being in her home. She caught the man in the act of robbing her, and she yelled out, "Stop! Acts 2:38." And Acts 2:38 says, in the complete Jewish Bible anyway, "Turn from sin, return to God, and each of you be immersed on the authority of Yeshua the Messiah into the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Ruach HaKodesh." The burglar, she didn't quote all that, she just said Acts 2:38. The burglar stopped in his tracks. And the woman calmly called the police and explained what she had done. As the officer handcuffed the man to take him in, he asked the burglar, "Why did you just stand there? All the old lady did was yell a scripture reference to you." "Scripture?" replied the burglar. "She said she had an axe and 2:38s. So today's message is called Setting Apart Shabbat. And humor is good to start setting apart Shabbat. It's from the Parashah Emor, which means to speak. And it's Leviticus 21 through 24. And just to review those passages, is anybody need any note paper? Is that what you're up there for, Linda? Alan? Alan just disappeared. Great timing. Chapter 21 has rules for the priests, the Kohanim. And chapter 22 goes on with the rules for the priests and the offerings. Chapter 23 is God's calendar. And if you're not familiar with that chapter is really worn out in my Bible because it has all of the appointed times, the Moedim, in it. And chapter 24 has some more instructions for the lampstand and the bread and a story about a blasphemer who was stoned. And as you are aware, over the past couple of months, I've been led to go through the Ten Commandments, the Asar Dabar, the Ten Words. And if you remember, when we got to the fourth commandment, we skipped it. And I told you the reason was that the fourth commandment is about Shabbat. And then I looked back at my notes and I found that just about a year ago, in February of last year, I did two messages on Shabbat. And they were called Shabbat Manna and Shabbat Shalom. And I encourage you to go listen to those. They're both on our podcast from February of 2012. Unfortunately, they're not on the videos, but they're on the podcasts. And this week's Parsha, when I got to Leviticus 23, contained a passage on Shabbat. And the Spirit of God spoke to me from that passage and said, it's time to teach on Shabbat again. So that's where we're going to go. And we're going to start by reading the fourth commandment. So if we could bring up that first slide of Exodus chapter 20, starting in verse 8. "Remember the day, Shabbat, the Sabbath, to set it apart for God. You have 6 days to labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is a Shabbat for Adonai, the Lord, your God. On it you are not to do any kind of work, not you, your son or your daughter, not your male or female slave, nor not your livestock, and not the foreigner staying with you inside the gates of your property. For in 6 days Adonai made heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them, but on the seventh day he rested. And this is why Adonai blessed the day, Shabbat, and separated it for himself." So today what I was led to talk about was kind of the core meaning of this commandment, this fourth commandment, where it talks about setting it apart for the Lord. And in Hebrew, that word is kadosho. The root of it is kodesh, which we sing at times, kadosh. But the root of it is sanctified or set apart, and it's to be set apart from the other days of the week, in other words, dedicated to the Lord. And in this passage that we just read, we are told what not to do, right? We're told not to work, but we're not really told how to set it apart for God. So what does that exactly mean, to set apart a day for God? And as I was praying about this, the Ruach gave me an analogy that kind of builds on Rabbi Ben's message last week and really a lot of what we heard here today from Linda and from Judith, how we are mishpucha. We are a family. And so in like 2 weeks, Mother's Day is coming. And Mother's Day is a day that is set apart for what? For mothers. And then a month later, Father's Day is coming, which is a day set apart for fathers. And I realized that to understand what it means to set Shabbat apart from the Lord, it helps to think about what we do and how we set apart these days for our mothers and our fathers. So what do we do on Mother's Day? Well, we probably the first thing that comes to anybody's mind is we honor our mother with gifts, right? We get her Mother's Day gifts, or our father. And the other thing that might have come to your mind is we get a card, and the card usually has something in it to express our love to our mother or our father, right? And then if we're able, we go and we spend time. We make sure that we don't have other things scheduled for that day, and we spend time with our mother or our father. And when we try to decide what are we going to do today, like what are we going to have for dinner, what do we do? We ask them, right? And we do what they want us to do. So we obey them, in a sense. So we either, you know, maybe they'll say, well, I'd like my favorite meal, and we make it, or we take them to their favorite restaurant. Does that jive with how all of you handle Mother's Day or Father's Day, or maybe how your children express it to you? So after you see that, what should we do to set a day apart for the Lord? Keen to see the parallels. Honor him with gifts, right? What are our gifts? Well, obviously there's the physical gifts of giving to the Lord, an offering, but there's also our time. So one of the ways of honoring the Lord is to give our time to him and express our love. That's what the cards did, right? So how do we express our love to the Lord to honor him? We worship. We sing songs. We express our love to the Lord. And we spend time with him. We spend time with him on that day. And then, of course, we also do what he wants. We obey him. So do you see the parallel there? It's almost identical with honoring our parents. So all those things are things that we're doing today. And I'm sure many of you have done them many days, but maybe you haven't seen the parallel between honoring your mother or father and honoring the Lord. But this week's Parsha in Leviticus 23, we are told one of the ways to set Shabbat apart that kind of connects with all the things that I mentioned, but I haven't mentioned it yet. And this instruction is very brief, and it builds on Rabbi Ben's message from last week. And I've got to tell you that when you think about this instruction, it has had a profound effect on the history and the culture of the entire world. And it has been instrumental in preserving God's people for 3,500 years. So I'm gonna read it to you. We weren't going to take the scroll out today because we're going to come to the Lord's table and we wouldn't have the time. But I'll read this to you in Hebrew and translate it as I go. Sheshet yamim, 6 days, ta'aseh malacha, 6 days you may do your work. Uvayom hashvi'i, and on the seventh day, Shabbat Shabbaton, it's a Sabbath of rest. Mikra Kodesh, a holy convocation should be on this day. Kol malacha lo ta'asu, all work you are not to do. Shabbat hi la Adonai. It is the Shabbat to the Lord. B'kol moshvotechem. in all of your dwelling places, and that word could be actually homes or towns or every place where you live. So that's the verse. It's the only verse in Leviticus 23 that speaks about Shabbat. And what is the very brief yet so important instruction? On Shabbat, there is to be a mikra kodesh, a holy convocation, an assembly, a gathering of the people set apart for the Lord. Well, that's why we're here today, right? We're having a mikra kodesh, and that's why we'll be here next week, and that's why we were here last week, because we're doing that. But how does this fit in the analogy of honoring our parents on their day? When we go to honor our parents, when we attempt to do it, don't we always try to get the whole family together to do it, right? And if you're a parent, or if you know how your parents feel, isn't that what really makes it special? The fact that the whole family has gathered together, and especially to eat together. We come together and eat together as a family with the parents, and that's what makes the day. So you can see that to set the Shabbat apart, as along with giving him gifts, along with expressing our love for him and obeying him, there's also very much the idea that we should come together as a family before him, because it's his family, and he loves to see us together, just like a mother or a father loves to see the family come together. And of course, you guys who have small children, you can relate to this with your parents because you got your kids with you all the time. But when we come together as a family, extended family, come together with the immediate family, it's the same thing. It's what it makes it special to the Lord, that all of his children have come together. They're in unity. They're all in agreement. They're doing what he wants them to be doing, which is having fellowship with him, and they're doing it all together. So it's really a beautiful thing to see all of you here today, because this is exactly what we're doing. We're honoring the Lord by coming together. And how has this command had a profound effect on the world's cultures? It is absolutely amazing that almost all the world's major calendars follow a seven-day cycle. Now, we would expect that of, you know, the Jewish calendar and the Christian calendar and the Muslim calendar. But if you look through history, the Babylonian calendar, the Roman calendar, the Hindu calendar, the Buddhist calendar, the early Chinese calendar, they all followed the seven-day cycle that God had established about of Shabbat. And I know in the former Soviet Union, there was an attempt at one point in time to change it to 10 days. And it totally flopped. Just could not break through. It's human. It's so much a part of human way of thinking. So most of the church keeps every seventh day as a day of worship too, but on a Sunday. And many churches teach that Sunday is a Shabbat, a day of rest. So I want to just take a minute, and I always do this when we talk about Shabbat, so those of you who heard me say this before, please excuse it, but just to talk about how do we deal with the issue of whether non-Jewish people should keep the Shabbat, whether that's a commandment or not. And just to understand this, the way I've handled this in the past is to think about the laws of God in three categories. There's the moral laws, which concern how we interact with each other, like don't kill, don't steal, don't lie, don't commit adultery. And then there's the spiritual laws, which concern how we relate to God. Love him with all your heart. Don't use his name in vain. Don't worship idols. And the Bible is very clear that both Jews and non-Jews, all who are followers of the Messiah, need to keep all of these laws. This is our lifestyle. It's not how we're saved by keeping them, because that's by trusting in the Messiah sacrifice, but we need to live according to those laws. And then we have a third category of the laws, which we call the Jewish laws. And the Jewish laws were given to Israel to set us apart as God's special people, to be a sign, to be the people who would bring forth the Messiah. And those laws involve keeping the appointed times, keeping certain food laws, circumcising our sons. And we understand that in the 15th chapter of the book of Acts, the Holy Spirit guided the early apostles and said that when non-Jewish people come to believe, they don't have to keep all of those laws, all the laws that would make them like Jewish people. So the question is, and this is always a tough question, okay, we got the moral laws, we got the spiritual laws, we got the Jewish laws. What is the laws about Shabbat? Which category does it fit into? And the tough thing is that it can fit into two categories. Because in Exodus chapter 31, verse 13, I have it up there, the Lord says, tell the people of Israel, you are to observe my Shabbats, for this is a sign between me and you through all your generations, so that you will know that I am Adonai who sets you apart for me. So here we see that Israel is commanded specifically to keep the Shabbat forever as a sign between us and God that he has set us apart. So if you look at that, you would say, well, that makes it like a Jewish law. It's for the people of Israel. And of course, this verse it's amazing how this verse has been fulfilled because Shabbat has served as a sign of the Jewish people all through history, all through the diaspora, wherever Jews lived, all through the world, you knew there was a Jewish community. How? Because if you went there on Saturday, they were not working. All the shops were closed, and the people were taking the day off. So it's this sign. And also, the law of Shabbat for the Jewish people had another very profound effect on Israel, on the people of Israel, because it is work to walk a long distance. We all have to live within what's called a Sabbath day's walk of the synagogue, so we can obey the command to have the Mikra Kodesh, the Holy Assembly, so we can come together and worship the Lord and have like Father's Day for him. And so by having that in place, that caused the Jewish people to live in neighborhoods where they didn't just scatter all over cities or all over the country, but they kept in a radius around the local synagogue. And in addition to that, we know that because they came together once a week, they stayed in social contact with each other. So they remained connected, remained as a family. So had a profound effect, but that's looking at it as a Jewish law. But on the other hand, people could say, some would say, setting aside a day per week to worship God, that's a spiritual law. Right? So can you see the conflict there about which they are? Some argue it's one of the Ten Commandments. It should be for everyone. So our position here at Shema Yisrael has always been that Shabbat laws are Jewish laws. And for those of us who are Jewish, that means if we are going to live as Jews, as a witness to our friends and family that you can be Jewish and be a believer in the Messiah, then we need to keep the Shabbat. Because that's a sign, of course, not as a means of salvation, remember that, but as a sign. Because that's one of our purposes, to demonstrate that we can continue to live as Jews. And we encourage, if you're not Jewish, that you can keep it too, because there's many benefits to it. But we need to also remember about the Shabbat, so important, we're not encouraging anybody to keep it the way the non-Messianic rabbis have taught it must be kept. Because if you study that just a little bit, you will see that they added in a whole bunch of man-made rules, a whole bunch of legalism that made the Shabbat into a burden rather than into a blessing or a delight. So we believe that there's great benefit to this, to keeping the Shabbat. And when a non-Jewish person, as some of you who are here today, is led by God to become part of the Messianic movement, keeping Shabbat is like your first step into that changed culture, because you're going from worshiping on Sunday to worshiping on a Saturday. It's the first step to becoming a ger. A ger is a non-Jewish person who has thrown their lot in with the Jewish people. And so if you're regularly attending here or some other Messianic congregation, you've already taken that step. So one of the questions people have about this is, why would anybody who seeks to obey the Bible not want to keep Shabbat on the seventh day? When that's the day God clearly says in the Bible that he has blessed and he commands us to set apart for him. And I think if you study church history at all, I've studied it a lot, it's obvious that this change was made in order for the church to separate itself from its Jewish roots, intentionally made to separate it from them. However, and this is very important, if we as a congregation took the position that all of the non-Jewish believers out there who are in churches, that they must be keeping Shabbat, we would see all of our Gentile brothers and sisters in churches as disobeying God right now, right? And that would mean that we in the Messianic movement would not be able to be in fellowship with them. And we know, I know very strongly that the Lord has called us to be a light to the church, not to distance ourselves from it. So we do not believe that the churches are sinning, the people in churches, because they're not keeping the Shabbat. We believe that God will reveal that to them sometime in the end times. So that's kind of my necessary little thing to make everybody understand how we deal with Shabbat here. But now I want to go on to discuss two Shabbat traditions that help us to set Shabbat apart. And I taught about these. Some of you attended something that the Fig Tree Bookstore put on about Shabbat a few months ago. And we looked at some of the traditions to keep Shabbat. So I'm going to go over a couple of those, but there's going to be kind of a new twist on that. So first of all, we need to understand that Shabbat begins at sundown on Friday. And the reason for that is because the Jewish day is reckoned from sundown to sundown because of what is said in the book of Genesis. In chapter 1, verse 5, it says, as speaking of the creation account, so there was evening and there was morning one day. So the Jewish people have always kept the day as starting in the evening and ending the next evening. And the beginning of the Shabbat is started with lighting candles. It's a very ancient Jewish tradition. And they are lit just before sunset on Friday. So there will be light in the home without having to kindle a fire on Shabbat. And that also is an obedience to a scripture. It's Exodus 35, verse 3, which says you are not to kindle a fire in your homes, in any of your homes, on Shabbat. So the candles are traditionally lit before the sun sets, before Shabbat starts, and then we have light in the home throughout the Shabbat. And they're traditionally lit by the woman of the house because the woman of the house generally has more influence over the spirit of the household. And so she's given the privilege of lighting the Shabbat candles. But if there's no lady in your house, that's fine. A man can light the candles and start the Shabbat that way. We have a messianic candle lighting blessing. It's different from the traditional candle lighting blessing, and it's different for an important reason. If you've ever heard the traditional candle lighting blessing, it says God has commanded us to light the Shabbat candles. And there's nothing in Scripture that says that. It's purely a tradition. So we have changed it, and you can get that blessing in the Fig Tree Bookstore. We have it printed out on like little cards. And you can also get candles and candlesticks in the Fig Tree Bookstore if you want to do that. Because the reason I'm talking about this is that the candle lighting time is really the way that we set apart Shabbat. It's the way we begin having this special day. And it's strange for Americans because it's evening. It's Friday evening, but that's when the Shabbat starts. And it should be a time of quieting down, coming into God's presence, and kind of turning off the world. It's the beginning of the Mikra Kodesh, the Holy Assembly, not in the synagogue, not in the large group like we have here, but in the home. That's a Mikra Kodesh, in the home, to begin to have a Shabbat there. And it can include, obviously, the immediate family, but it could also include people that are invited over for what we call Erev Shabbat, Shabbat evening. Now, how this has touched my heart in a very, very significant way is that for the first 8 years that I was the rabbi here, we had a Saturday morning service and a Erev Shabbat service on Friday evening. And we stopped it about 2004 when we began doing the Tuesday evening service. It was just a little bit too much. But for those 8 years, we always started our service by lighting the Shabbat candles. And it was just a beautiful moment of peacefulness. Turn the lights out, light the candles, recite the blessing, and sing a song after that. And so when we stopped having the Friday evening service, I would be at home for Friday evening. And since I hadn't been home, we hadn't been doing that. But I felt compelled to light the candles on Friday evening because I just was so used to it, to starting the Shabbat that way. I just missed it. It was like, oh, Shabbat hasn't started. We haven't lit the candles. So we began to light them at home just before dinner. And for me, it's a way of separating. It's a way of separating the week from the Shabbat, bringing the work week to the close and beginning the Shabbat, setting it apart for the Lord. And even though, you know, I have to prepare for the service the next morning, I try to get everything done before we do that so that the rest of the evening is really a Shabbat. And that's how we do it at home. And I'm not just saying this to, you know, to tell what we do, but I want to encourage all of you, whether you're Jewish or you're not Jewish, to begin doing this, whether you're home alone or whether you have a family at home or whether you invite friends over, or I believe one of our Chavra groups meets on Erev Shabbat, Jerry's group, to start the Shabbat with the lighting of the candles. The second tradition is the bread and the wine or the grape juice. And so during a traditional Erev Shabbat in the home, after the candles are lit and the blessing is said, the man of the house recites the special blessing, which is called the Kiddush, over the wine or the grape juice. And you've heard this, I'm sure, it's the Borei Pri HaGofen. And then everybody takes a drink. And then we greet each other with Shabbat Shalom, which is Sabbath peace in Hebrew. And that's when Shabbat has officially begun. And after blessing the wine or the grape juice, then the blessing over the bread is recited and the loaf is broken. And traditionally on Erev Shabbat, we use two loaves of challah bread, the braided bread. The word challah in Hebrew means it's a cake used for offerings. It's actually in the book of Exodus. That word is used, the portion that was for the Lord. And again, you can get not the challah breads, but you can get the blessings on the card in the fig tree. Why two loaves? In Hebrew, it's lechem mishneh, the two loaves. Well, the two loaves are really have a great meaning behind them. They commemorate the manna that fell from heaven when our ancestors wandered in the desert for 40 years after the Exodus from Egypt. Remember on Friday what happened with the manna? A double portion of manna appeared so that they wouldn't have to go out and collect it on Shabbat. So the two loaves remind us that God will provide for our material needs. This is so important. Even if we refrain from working on Shabbat, because there's the big test of faith. Can I take a day and set it apart for God and not work? And, you know, a day is 1/7 of a week. That's actually a tithe of your time, and it's bigger than a tenth. So it's actually bigger than your monetary tithe, which the scriptures say is a tenth. It's a seventh, which is significantly bigger than that. But that's the faith step of being willing to take that day and spend it with the Lord. And the breads, after they're broken, traditionally are passed around on a plate instead of being handed to people. And the reason for that is to stress that we're not receiving our bread from other people, but from the Lord himself. So it's passed around on this plate. And so now this begins to get into something very, very significant. Passing that challah around on the platter demonstrates that little gathering, or it could even be yourself, is a mikra kodesh. It's an assembly eating together. You're eating the bread and you're drinking the grape juice before the Lord. And also, those of you who have attended a traditional synagogue or many other Messianic synagogues know that after every Shabbat service, there's something called a kiddush. And that is wine or grape juice and challah and fellowship, usually in the lobby. And everybody goes out, the blessings are recited, the bread is passed around, everybody gets some of it, and then people hang out and talk to each other. We used to do that here, but we stopped because the floor was getting too dirty. I'd love to go back to doing that. Now, here's the thing that's significant spiritually about this. The origin of these customs is that people are eating together before the Lord. And that's a theme in the Tanakh, in the scriptures, that when people come together and they are in God's presence, they often share a meal together. And I'll just give you some references here because we're not going to go into it. But in Genesis 14, Melchizedek brought wine and bread to share with Abraham. In Genesis 18, the elders of Israel, when Moses' father-in-law came, they brought food and they ate with him before the Lord, it says. And then in Genesis 24, the 70 elders of Israel went up to be in the presence of the Lord and they ate and drank in his presence. So we see this pattern that this is something that is done, that we eat and drink in the presence of the Lord. And of course, Yeshua built on the profound significance of this, of eating bread and wine or grape juice in what he did by giving us what I like to call the covenant renewal meal of the new covenant. And that, of course, was given at a Passover Seder, which is a time when people especially eat and drink before the Lord as he commands us to do. So he gave us the Lord's Supper. We call it the Sudat Adonai. Sudat means supper, the Lord, the Lord's Supper, as this covenant renewal meal of the new covenant. And it consists of the same thing for Shabbat, the bread and the wine to be eaten before the Lord, but representing his body and his blood. And of course, when he gave it on Passover, he gave it as unleavened bread, but it's still bread. It's still bread and wine. So all these things are Mikra Kodesh, and they're all things of us eating together before the Lord. So in 1 Corinthians 11, Rabbi Shaul quoted Yeshua, and this is what he said in verse 25. Do this as often as you drink it as a memorial to me. So Yeshua is referring to taking the cup in this case, but of course that would be probably also the bread. It would be also the bread. And he's saying, do this as often as you drink it in memorial to me. And I don't know about you, but that statement raises a big question. What did he mean by as often as you drink it? And I see four possible interpretations of that question. First of all, when taking the third cup and eating the afikoman on Passover during the Seder, because that's what he was doing. It was actually at a Passover Seder. And that would mean doing it once a year, right? Or maybe twice if you go to two Passover Seders, which a lot of people do, but once or twice in succession per year. So that's one way of interpreting as often as you do it. Another way would be to say as often as you have a Mikra Kodesh, whenever you have a holy convocation. And we know that that's how the Catholic Church has interpreted this, because every time there's a service, it's a mass, they call it, and what do? They have the bread and the wine, because then they don't have services without it. That's it. They always have it. So that's the second way. So we go from one extreme, once a year, to this other extreme, every day, right? The third way is how we've done it here. And the way we've done it here, if you're not aware of it, is we have sought the Spirit. I have sought the Spirit of God as to when to do this. And pretty much I only do it when it's connected to the message, not when it's like we're doing a message on something totally different, or just because it's the right time, we're going to do it every month. We did at one point in time do it once a month, but we found it just didn't work because it didn't connect with what we were doing. So that's another way. We end up doing it here like maybe four or five times a year. The fourth way, so that's three ways. Once a year, every day, as the Spirit leads. Okay. The fourth way is whenever you eat bread and wine or grape juice before the Lord, which is a new way of thinking about it, right? And that could be every Erev Shabbat if you're doing this. So here's what's happened with me. As I studied this in preparation for the thing, the Fig Tree Book Tour put on, I became convinced that the bread and the wine or the grape juice, doing that on Erev Shabbat, that tradition has been part of Judaism for so long, from before the time of Yeshua, that I come to believe that that's actually what he meant. Because, yes, he was keeping Passover, but it was so much thing that was done every week at least once a week. And it was certainly beyond Passover, but I believe what he was saying was, do this as often as you do it in remembrance of me. What he was saying was, as often as you take the juice or the wine and the bread and recite the blessing over them and eat them before the Lord, do it in remembrance of me. Okay, now that's probably shaking a lot of you up right now because it's very non-traditional. But that's how, since we did the study, which was a couple of months ago, we've been doing it in my home. So every night when we light the candle, Friday night rather, when we light the candles and we get out some grape juice and some bread and we say the blessings over them and we remember the Lord's body and blood when we do that. And it's been a blessing to be able to do that. So I want to recommend this tradition to you with this new feature. As Shabbat begins on Friday, light the candles as a family, or even if you're a single person, or as if you're a chavurah group, or if you invite somebody over, recite the blessing over the grape juice or the wine. That's the Borei Pri Hagafen one. And then, very simply, recite this verse that Yeshua spoke. For this is my blood, which ratifies the new covenant, my blood shed on behalf of many, so that they may have their sins forgiven. And drink that cup, not just in recognition that Shabbat is starting, but in memory of the new covenant and of his shed blood. Then recite the blessing over the bread, the challah, or matzah, or whatever bread you're using. And that's the one that is Hamotzi Lechem Min Ha'aretz, who brings forth bread from the earth. And, of course, during Passover, that would be unleavened bread. But then recite what Yeshua spoke over this. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in memory of me. And break that bread and eat it in memory of his body, recognizing his body. And what you'll be doing is you'll be making that Erev Shabbat into the Lord's Supper. And there's a tremendous benefit in this every week. Why is there a benefit in this? Because there is a strengthening that happens. Let me show you this. When writing about the Lord's Supper in 1 Corinthians 11, this is what Rabbi Shaul said. And it comes out of kind of a negative verse, 29. It says, for a person who eats and drinks without recognizing the body eats and drinks judgment upon himself. This is why many among you are weak and sick, and some have died. So he's giving this in a negative context. But what he's saying is that weakness, sickness, and even death are the result of partaking the Lord's Supper with a poor attitude. So what does that imply? Well, this is what I see that implies. If you take the Lord's Supper with a good attitude, it's a source of the opposites. You see that? Strength, health, and long life. Okay? So I believe there's healing power in Yeshua's broken body, so we should do it often. Now, why is there healing power? Well, some might think it's magical. It's got supernatural power. You know, it's become something when we say the blessing over it that is beyond just grape juice and bread. But I don't believe that's it. I believe it's because we're exhorted in this passage in 1 Corinthians to search our hearts and recommit ourselves to reconciling with whoever we're having a problem with and to renewing the covenant. And by doing that every week, it's going to keep us healthy. So this comes around to the connection that we've drawn many times between what we call spiritual roots and our health. That things like unforgiveness and anger and bitterness and envy and things like that actually have physical effects on our health. So if once a week we come before the Lord and we say, well, I can't take this until you show me, Lord, if there's something I need to repent of or there's somebody I need to be reconciled with. So I'm going to be serious and I'm going to seek your face on this. And it actually happens, we will be more healthy. That's the healing power. Now, you're probably thinking, this is pretty radical, because this recommendation to take the Lord's Supper in your homes on Erev Shabbat contradicts many, many centuries of church teaching. Everybody realize that? church has taught for millennium that only an ordained minister can give the sacraments to the people, right? Why am I contradicting this teaching? Well, the first reason is, can't find it here. If anybody can find it here, I'd be happy to read it, but can't find it here. So it is a rule of man, and I can understand why this rule was put into place. It was put into place so that people would not do it in an unworthy way. They would recognize the Lord's body. But also, we understand that this rule in the church gave the priests power over the people. Because unless you submitted to the priest, you know, you cannot take communion, because only the priests could give communion. And what's really interesting is with the Protestant Reformation, nobody really mentions this much, but did they change it? No, no. Most denominations still, it has to be an ordained minister that you know, administers communion. But I'm saying, and you know, you can throw tomatoes at me. I don't think that's the word of the Lord. I think that's the rule of men. And so I want to encourage you to take it on your own. And take it in a worthy way. Don't treat it lightly, but to take it seriously. And as we're ending up today, we're going to come together to the Lord's table. And I'd like to give you, we're going to end up with going through the instructions that Rabbi Shaul gave in 1 Corinthians 11, just as a way of kind of getting you to be able to do it yourself. Okay, so 1 Corinthians 11, starting in verse 26. At this time, could I have the ushers give out the grape juice and the matzah? And can you all concentrate while this is being given out so I can go on? Hannah, we'll do that instead, okay? For now, I'm going to just go on, and then we'll get to this. All right, and let me grab some here. They're up here. Okay. So 1 Corinthians 11, 26. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes. So by doing this, you're proclaiming the death of the Lord. What does that mean? Well, the entities that the Lord's death need to be proclaimed to are the forces of darkness. So by doing this, you are proclaiming that he died and that death broke the power of the forces of darkness. Verse 27, therefore, whoever eats the Lord's bread or drinks the Lord's cup in an unworthy manner will be guilty of desecrating the body and blood of the Lord. So this is very important. Don't do it in an unworthy manner. How do you avoid doing it in an unworthy manner? Well, the next verse tells us very clearly, verse 28. So let a person examine himself first, and then he may eat of the bread and drink from the cup. And this consists simply of asking the Spirit of God to reveal if there's anything we need to repent of, any way that we have been falling short, that we've been disobedient, that we've been turning away, that we've been coming cold, all those kinds of things. And also to reveal if there's any unforgiveness, if there's any bitterness toward anyone, to repent of those things. But if possible, and it's, of course it's not always possible, to make reconciliation with anyone who's present. But also that can be started by making a decision and committing yourself to make reconciliation later with that person if they're not present. And also, this is a time to offer forgiveness and reconciliation to anyone who has offended you. So it's got to go both ways. Is there anybody whom I have offended? I need to ask the Spirit of God to show me and then act on that. And is there anybody who has offended me? I need to act on that by going to that person. And then Paul makes it very serious where he says, for a person who eats and drinks without recognizing the body, eats and drinks judgment upon himself, and this is why many among you are weak and sick, and some have died. Now, this is very important to understand, recognizing the body. And I don't know if Paul meant it to have a double meaning, but to me, it always has had a very powerful double meaning. And here's the two meanings. First, we recognize that, if we could back up to that verse there, verse 29, yeah. The first meaning is to recognize that it was Yeshua's physical body that was sacrificed for our healing. His blood was shed for the forgiveness of our sins, but he was whipped, he was bruised, his body was broken for our healing, both physical and emotional, and for the breaking of curses, because his body was hung on the cross, and the scripture says whatever, when a body is hung on the cross, a curse is upon that, so he took the curses. So that's the first thing, recognizing that it's his body that brought us healing, physical, emotional, mental, and relational. So we're to recognize it by speaking out our conviction that his body has healing power. His blood and his body have healing power. But the second thing of recognizing the body is really very profound, recognizing that we are all part of one body. Recognize the body around us. And that is where the instruction to make reconciliation, to make sure you're right with everybody, comes in. We can't get away from each other, so we have to work out our issues. Why can't we get away from each other? Because we're mishpacha. We always will be mishpacha. So we can't just say, you know, I don't get along with you, I'm out of here. God will not let us do that. We have to get things straight with each other. And then verse 31 says, if we would examine ourselves, we would not come under judgment. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned along with the world. So here, Rabbi Shaul is simply restating that need to be open to the Spirit of God, revealing the things we need to deal with before we can take this meal. So let's just take a minute right now and ask the Holy Spirit to reveal to us if there's anything we need to repent of, if there's anybody we need to go to.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670, or you can write us at 1326 North Whitten Road, Rochester, New York, 14609, or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service, Saturday mornings at 10 a.m., Complete Children's Program Interpretation for the Deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. We hope you'll visit a free Messianic Jewish bookstore located in the lobby of Shema Yisrael. Call for hours. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bagels and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick. You can also hear Bagels and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Reg A. Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the scriptures.